Hello, this is Bern, and on today's episode, I'm going to be sharing with you why you are not getting the deep, devotional, passionate love that you're seeking and what you can do about it starting today. Hello, this is Bern. Welcome to your greatlifetv.com, a space where I share with ambitious, conscious, heart-centered, successful women how you can get the relationship that you want and attract the kind of man that you want. No need for gimmicks or manipulation of any kind. Now, does this sound like you? Are you a woman who feels like the vast majority of men that you're attracted to are not attracted back in the same way? Or you have guys who are attracted to you, but they're not the kind of guys that you want? Do you feel like you are someone who wants commitment and passion, but the kind of connection that you have with men leads you to believe that men don't want that? It's not true, but it feels true to you. Are you someone who maybe feels like a third wheel? Your friends are going out on weekends and doing fun things with their partners, and here you come along. They like you and they don't say anything about it. They actually encourage you to come with them, but you feel deep down inside that kind of like they're doing you a favor, like you could be doing something different and they're bringing you along because they don't want you to be lonely. Do you get tired? And by tired, I mean like you want to punch someone in the face every time a well-intentioned but annoying human being says, "I can't believe you're still single, but you're so beautiful, you're so cute, you're so smart. I just can't understand why you're not getting a man." If you ever feel that way, this is for you. Are you someone who feels like the best years of your life are slipping by you and there's nothing you can do about it because the harder you try to find this relationship, the more difficult it becomes? Do you feel like going online and searching for the right partner causes more anxiety and more pain and more of what you don't want? Do you feel like sometimes you start doubting that this thing is for you, or maybe you start telling to yourself that it's not on the cards for you? Well, if you feel any of those things, I'm here to tell you that you're not crazy and you're not alone. There's two reasons, fundamental reasons, my dear, why finding love feels so hard. Finding the kind of love that in today's day and age we crave is very hard. It doesn't just feel hard, it is hard, but there's two levels of hardship and I'll explain them to you. The first one is a natural level of hardship. Why? Because there's a law hidden somewhere there that says anything that's great and amazing, it's gonna be hard. You want to be a doctor, it's going to be hard. You want deep devotional love that lasts for 50 years or more, it's going to be hard. Why? Because think about it. Since the 4 billion years that life was created, and there's never been the possibility that we have right now to be with another human being in a monogamous relationship that stands the test of time, that lasts 50, 60, 70 years. I mean, that's never existed in human history. Why? Think about it. The beginning of 1900, if you lived to be 40 years of age, that was average. So being with someone for life meant maybe 10 years because you got married younger. So this is something new. We're uncharted territory and we want to create a relationship that has a friendship component, has a love component, has a devotional component, has an excitement component of chemistry, but security. So we want so many things from this type of relationship and we don't have the skills to create it because we've never experienced this in the past. We've experienced love for short periods of time. We've experienced monogamy at some level. This is the highest level of consciousness that we've ever had, and we want something deeper than what people before us had. So that's one reason why love is hard, feels hard, because it is hard. The second reason why it feels hard is because you may be doing things counterproductively. You might be stepping into love in ways that instead of bringing it closer to you, are pushing it away. You might be secretly feeling like there's a pain in you creating love. So when you go into it, you don't give it your best because subconsciously, if you give it your best, you experience more pain. So there are reasons that have nothing to do with nature, have everything to do with your psychology, your level of awareness of relationships, the way you step up in the world, the way you understand men, the questions you ask, the boundaries you set. And what I'm here to do is to give you a little bit more clarity today, so that A, you're not feeling crazy for not getting the love that you want. B, you're not feeling like a failure because you're not a failure. You just haven't learned what it takes to create a fulfilling relationship. So rather than giving you some stupid techniques and strategies or how to text him the right way or how to render him senseless at your feet or how to bring him back from falling in love with somebody else, all that bullshit that doesn't work, I'm going to give it to you straight. Why? Because If nothing else, I want to make sure that you don't follow the wrong rabbit hole in this pursuit of love. The first thing I want to share with you is that if you are addressing the wrong cause, the first reason why women don't get this is because they address the wrong cause. Men do the same thing. Addressing the wrong cause means that you tell yourself a sweet little lie innocently. For example, I've had so many conversations with women reach out to me from all over the world, every walk of life, every age group, every size, every color, every religion, and tell me, "Bern, I'm not getting love." And I ask her, "Why are you not getting love?" And she says, "Well, I just haven't met the right guy." Well, at some level that could be true. It's not 100%, but at some level it could be true. But here's why it's not fully true. Because if I tell you right now, here's a person in this room, and that person's dead. And then you ask me, "Well, why did he die?" And I say, "Well, he died because his heart stopped." That's one level of truth. If you go deeper and you say, "Bern, why did the heart stop?" And I say, "Well, he was doing meth, heroin, and cocaine at the same time." Well, that's the real reason why the heart stopped, right? So in your specific scenario, not meeting the guy might be part of the answer, but the bigger question is, if you've been alive for 30, 40 years, why haven't you met the guy? It's not just because the guy hasn't been out there. There's things you're doing and ways you're seeing life and ways of you to showing up that are preventing you from either seeing him, attracting him, connecting with him, inspiring him, being inspired to connect more with him. And it's just, I would say, lazy to say, "I just haven't met him." You haven't met him perhaps because you haven't done it right. And not because you're not smart, not because you're not accomplished, not because you're not awesome, but because you haven't learned what it takes. So this first problem is so prevalent because most human beings who are attempting to change the meeting of their soulmate, they're not getting it. They're attempting to change the symptom versus the problem. So imagine that you say, "Well, I keep attracting unavailable men." Attracting unavailable men or falling for unavailable men is not a problem, it's a symptom. Why would you fall for unavailable men? Well, because if you fall for unavailable men, they'll never abandon you because they never were in it to begin with. It's not something you would consciously say because you're smart, but subconsciously that's what's going on inside perhaps. Or you're attracting unavailable men because you get to go through this roller coaster of emotion, this highs and lows, this soap opera of pain and excitement. It feels more exciting than being in a relationship that perhaps is boring. So there's nothing boring about this hot and cold thing. It's just destroying you inside and you may not be realizing it. So what I mean by addressing the wrong cause is you're addressing the symptom versus the problem. So long as you address the symptom, it's not gonna happen. I'll give you an example, practical specific example in my own life. I connected with a woman called Alicia who reached out to me several years ago and she felt that her problem was exactly this one. I haven't met the guy. And when I dug deeper, it was clear to me in the first 3 minutes why she hadn't met the guy. She hadn't met the guy because she was not showing up in a way that allowed her to connect with the guy. She wasn't showing in a way that inspired him. She wasn't showing with aliveness, passion, excitement. She was stepping into hopelessness. Her level of light inside that was being expressed through her body and through her smile was 1/10 of what it could be when she's excited. So she was basically saying, "I'm connecting with tons of guys and none of them seem to want this kind of relationship and none of them are inspiring me." No guys were inspiring her because she wasn't inspiring herself. So here's what I did. I decided to work with her and focus mostly on addressing the right cause, which is her lack of aliveness, excitement, passion, self-love, self-ignition, fire in the belly. And within a couple of months, this shifted radically for her. Why? Because she met a man that would not have been attracted to her in the first place, and she wouldn't have what it took to sustain it because in her life she hadn't before. And from this place of being and expressiveness and passion and enjoyment, this guy fell in love with her. And so much so that they decided to get engaged a year later. She wrote this beautiful letter where she explained to me how this whole thing was evolving, and then a year later, she decided to get married. And then 2 years later, they had a beautiful baby daughter. And I'm sharing some pictures here so you can see that this stuff is real. But the truth of how I was able to help Alicia to get what she wanted to, from going to, "This is not happening, I feel disappointed, guys are not awesome," to, "I have met my soulmate, my best friend, my lover," and all happening from addressing the right cause. So that's the first real reason why you're not getting what you want. You're addressing the wrong cause. Second reason, there's a lack of belief, lack of confidence, lack of self-worth, lack of aliveness, lack of feeling your amazingness as a woman and your ability to show up and fill up a room with your presence. So you might believe it or not doing it, or maybe you don't believe it, or maybe you have a little bit of lack of confidence, maybe a lack of confidence. So when women show up in a relationship and they doubt in their greatness, even though they are inherently great and intelligent and beautiful. So if you're doubting that your extra 5 pounds are causing you to not feel beautiful, regardless of how beautiful you look, that doubt will make you look unattractive. You could have 20 extra pounds and look amazing if you own it. But if you're not owning it, then you come across as someone who doesn't fully step into herself and doesn't love herself. So that's the second reason. Lack of belief, lack of confidence, lack of self-worth. When push comes to shove, doubting in your greatness, and therefore the result of that is you accept a lot less. You're willing to take lack of respect sometimes, so you can't set strong boundaries. Why? Because if you set strong boundaries, you feel in your mind, subconsciously, he's going to leave me. So when you change the way you show up in the world, the level of confidence and the level of self-worth, things change almost immediately. I'm not saying you meet your soulmate immediately, but things start shifting very, very quickly. Third reason why you're not getting what you want is subconsciously, and I alluded to this a little bit, you feel like getting it or the process of getting it is more painful than the comfortable pain that you've gotten yourself used to. If you go to, I don't know, a town in South Texas and you enter a home and outside the home on the porch, you see a beautiful dog that's moaning and groaning, and you ask the owner, why is he moaning and groaning? And Bob says, he's moaning and groaning because he's sitting on a nail. And you say, well, why doesn't he move from the nail? Because it's not painful enough to move from the nail. Does that make sense? Sometimes you feel subconsciously that the process of finding love is more painful than the reality of experiencing, or that if you were to experience love, well, now there's something more at stake. What if this guy then leaves you after he loves you? What if he discovers the fraud that you feel that you are subconsciously, and then you have to show up more? You have to be naked emotionally, spiritually, and psychologically. And that scares the hell out of you. So it's easier to say, well, I'm not getting the love that I want because the guys are not showing up, or because I attract unavailable men, or because truly you are attracting unavailable men, than it is to actually fall off a 100-story building should you fall in love completely and then the guy leave you. That's abandonment. This is just pain. Does that make sense? I'll give you another example to show you how this can be shifted. I connected with a woman by the name of Ashley, beautiful young woman, bright eyes, just such a powerful being. And when I connected with her, she was going through sadness, almost entering into depression, but just going through sadness of different kinds. And the biggest reason she was sad is for, well, two reasons. One, her lover, best friend, soulmate had just died. 4 years earlier, her husband, boyfriend, soulmate died. She was sitting on her house. Somebody knocked on her door and said, Ashley, he died. And he died in the war in Iraq. So she felt devastated. And here's the thought that she developed. Her belief was that I will never be able to find a lover, soulmate of the quality that I had with him. Why? If she did find him, in her mind, she was in some small way betraying the love of his late husband. In her mind, it was taking away from the truth, the authenticity, and the love. So she developed a belief that helped her to not have to betray the memory of her late husband. So what happened? When we connected, I helped her to see how the love that she experienced with her late husband, Jack is his name, was his name, was not going to be removed from or going to be supplanted. It was going to be in addition to the love that she found, and also that the love that she found was going to be in great measure based on the resonance she'd already experienced, and that the light and love that she experienced with her late husband was going to be part of the reason that she could experience this new love, because she'd already found that she's going to find that resonance again, and the love that she experienced and the love that she could find right now would mesh, and it's going to be a combination of both. And the moment she experienced that, her guilt lifted. And the next morning, from when we had this powerful interaction, she enters Whole Foods and she's walking around, and a man stops her and says, "You are so beautiful and radiant. I just have to tell you that." Never in her life had a man stopped her at a grocery store to tell her that. One day after we do this, she experiences a shift inside. No change in her clothes, no change in her weight, no change in her anything. No Botox, no surgery. Her lively, alive self shows up with that weight lifted, and somebody sees something in her. Now, that gave her the notion that this is possible. Now, what happened 3 months later? She connected with a guy who saw this beauty, this power, this passion in her, and said, I want to take it all the way. So she started pursuing her so strongly and ended up proposing to her. And I remember this vividly. I remember how I was browsing through Facebook and I see a picture of her in the Eiffel Tower with this man with this huge ring saying, yes, I do. So beautiful. I remember also the wedding, the pictures of this amazing, beautiful wedding and her feeling so alive. And then I remember he went to climb Mount Kilimanjaro, and at the top of Mount Kilimanjaro shared on a poster for Facebook and Instagram, it's a girl, it's a baby girl. It brings chills to my heart to remember this, and all of it, everything was possible as a result of her courage and us focusing on removing that subconscious obstacle of why love was more painful if she found it. Once we removed it, this was possible, it happened. Fourth reason why you're not getting what you want, you have lack of clarity in terms of what it is that you do want. And you don't have lack of clarity because you're not smart enough. You have lack of clarity because having clarity sometimes means that you feel like a failure if you don't get it. Let me tell you what I mean. I connect with so many women who tell me, Bern, I ask her, I mean, do you want children? I don't know. And I say, don't tell me you don't know. Yes or no. If you have to put your life in it right now and it's a yes or a no, depending upon what you say, what would you say? It's a yes. The reason she says it's a maybe is because she feels she can't have it. So the moment you get yourself to say it's a maybe, let's say a guy shows up and he says, I don't want children. Well, if it's a maybe he's your guy. But if you know for sure as hell that you want children, then that guy is not your guy and you move on. If you know that you want a guy who's in his masculine and who's pursuing you, and then you connect with a guy who expects you to pursue him, what happens? Well, if you're not clear on what you want, then you pursue him. If you're clear on what you want, you move on and give him a chance to step up. If he doesn't want to step up, then you say goodbye. Lack of clarity as to what you want is part of the reason you're not getting it. Second reason you're not getting it, sometimes you do know what you want, but you're not a match to it. I'll just be straight. I mean, I'm giving you the truth the way I see it, because none of your girlfriends are going to say this thing to you. None of your friends are going to say this to you. I'm giving it to you straight to your face right now. Sometimes you have a clear list. You have 150 items of what you want, but you're not a resonant match. You want a masculine guy, you're not in your feminine. You want a guy who's full of life, you're doing mid-mast in terms of aliveness and expressiveness and passion. You want a guy to fall in love with you and you're not in love with your life. So it's a mismatch, right? So part of getting what you want is turning it around and being a resonant match to the kind of partner that you want. I'll give you another example to share with you how this is so possible. I connected with a beautiful woman from Chile called Pammy several years ago, and when she reached out to me, she was sharing with me the problem the way she saw it. The problem she saw is the kind of man that I want is not available. And my thought was, he is available, sweetie, but he's not available to you the way you're showing up. She was not being a resonant match. So the only thing we worked on first and foremost was ending her mid-mass level of expressiveness, her depression. She wasn't going through a depression at that point. Figure out ways to create more meaning in her life, step into more of what she wanted. She started her own business, which is doing great, by the way. She stepped into more of the passions that she had. We worked really hard on her creating the kind of resonance that would make it a no-brainer for a guy to see her 75 miles away and say, you're the one for me. I want to connect with you. Once she showed up that way, guess what happened? A man saw her and fell in love with her. Something that hadn't happened. For years, she hadn't found this thing. She found him. He found her, actually. She didn't find him. He found her and proposed to her and got married. And they live in this amazing place right now. They travel the world together. And I've had the privilege of having conversations with him. Why? Because she's my friend now. And it's such a beautiful relationship. Not that it doesn't have problems, because all relationships have problems, but it's a beautiful relationship and it's continuing to grow. So that is what happens when you're able to find a way to become a resonant match to that which you're seeking. Last reason that I'll share with you right now is too much masculine energy or disempowered feminine. So here's what I mean. Masculine energy is part of who you are and it's necessary and there's nothing wrong with it. Too much masculine energy, as it relates to connecting with men, will attract a weak man, will attract a guy who's looking for a mommy. The inability to relax into your heart, the inability to show up with radiance, the inability to lean back where you want to do all the work makes the wrong type of guy for what you want attracted to you. This empowered feminine means that you're open and radiant, but you show up super needy. Why? Because you're not meeting your own needs. So you are expecting for a guy to fill the empty, empty, empty void that cannot be filled with anything other than yourself. So when you showed up with too much masculine energy or with a disempowered sense of the feminine, instead of open, you show up as needy, then you also don't get what you want. So I hope these real reasons, not the things that some people are telling you are the real reasons. You're not, your profile is not set up properly. That's not the real reason. You haven't met the right guy. It's not the real reason. There's no good men in your city. It's bullshit. The real reasons why you're not getting what you want have a lot more to do with this. Hope this is helpful to you. If it is, I'm going to ask you to do three things. Number one, click like on this video. Number two, subscribe to my channel. And click the little bell if you want to be notified of new episodes. Number three, first link in the description of this video, you'll find a way to take this learning deeper. And it's a masterclass that I created. If you click on the first link, enter your name and email. Once you click on that link, and it will take you to that masterclass right away. If you want more help, hand-holding, and you don't want videos, you want actual accountability and strategy customized to your needs, then second link in the description of this video will allow you to apply to work with me. Thank you so much for connecting with me. And as always, I challenge you to live a full and a conscious life.